I bow to you, Allah, Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you, Allah, 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 you are my Lord. I bow to you, Allah, 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 you are my Lord. I bow to you, Allah. I bow to you, Allah, Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you, Allah, Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you, Allah, Allah, you are my Lord.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم. I welcome my dear brothers and sisters in Islam to the first episode in our series, the A to Z series, inshallah. Your brother in Islam, Bilal Ismail, all the way from South Africa with you for the series, inshallah. What's this series all about? Bi-ithnillahi ta'ala, we will be going through various chapters, various topics in the Sharia, but in the manner of the alphabet, in the manner of A to Z, insha'Allah. Let us see. This episode, we begin with A to Z of purification, or A to Z of Tahara. We know that Muhammad ibn Abdullah, our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has stated, At-tuhur shatrul iman. The verily purification is a portion of iman. We know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the noble Quran has stated, Inna Allah yuhibbu at-tawwabin wa yuhibbu al-mutatahhirin. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who turn to Him continuously in tawbah, in repentance, and He also loves those who are pure. Purification, a super important matter in our Sharia, as we will learn, insha'Allah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, we begin with the letter A. And A is for what in the chapter of purification? A is for what? A is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether it be salah, whether it be zakah, whether it be hajj, whether it be anything in our sharia, A is always for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The creator of the heavens and the earth. You have a young kid, and the parent hopes that his first words would be what? Would be Allah. You ask the young kid, who is your Rabb? Who is your Khaliq? And we hope that the kid says, Allah. So easy on the tongue it is to say Allah. It is a word which comes from the heart of every single Muslim. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who revealed this noble Quran to us, which would be recited until the final day. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. We find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of everything, you have the blue whale in the ocean, the largest mammal known to man, subhanallah. This largest mammal, who feeds it? Who provides for it? Who sustains it? None other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If, for example, you go to the desert and you look for a stone, you pick up the stone and you find an ant under it, or you find a lizard under it. In the middle of the desert with no plantation, no food that you can see, who's the one who provides for it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your granny, your grandfather at the age of 70, 80, 90, when they try to sit down and they find it difficult, when they wake up and they find it difficult, how easy on their tongue the first thing they say is, Allah, Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us tawfiq that the final moments of our life in this world, our final kalima, our final words on our tongues, that it should be La ilaha illallah. Man kana akhir kalamihi La ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannah. Whoever his final words in this dunya are La ilaha illallah, then for him is paradise. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, everything that we do, it is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah states, Qul, and say, Inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen. La sharika lah. That's my prayer, my fasting, my zakah, my hajj, my slaughter. Everything is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For verily, any action of the Muslim, any action of the human being, it would only be accepted if, number one, it is in accordance to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and number two, it is done with ikhlas. It is done with sincerity. As the scholars, they state, as the ulama have mentioned, that how many a massive deed it is made minuscule due to the fact that the man had corrupt intention. And how many a small tiny action it is magnified because the individual had a noble intention, subhanallah. So ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah, whether it be purification or any other act of worship, the one we should remember at the beginning and the end is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We move on bi-ithnillahi ta'ala after remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the chapter of purification, A is for Allah and B is for what? B is for Bismillah. Yes, subhanallah. Before we begin this wudu, we take the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For verily, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our Nabi, he has stated, لا وضوء لمن لم يذكر اسم الله تعالى عليه رواه أحمد. This hadith reported in the Musnad of Imam Ahmed that there is no wudu, no purification for that individual who does not take the name of Allah at the beginning of his wudu. So we say Bismillah and then we begin our purification. And this is the opinion of majority of the scholars, that before your wudu you say Bismillah. We have the Hanbali scholars of the opinion that it is wajib, but majority of the scholars, it is sunnah, insha'Allah. And although this hadith was mentioned with regards to wudu, the scholars have made qiyas, and they have stated, whether it be your wudu, or even your ghusl, your full, complete ablution, or even if it be your tayammum, you say Bismillah before you begin that act of purification. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, a question many a time comes up. What if I am taking my wudu in the bathroom and the toilet's there? What if, for example, the toilet seat's very close by and I'm taking my wudu in the sink? Do I also mention the name of Allah in that place? For verily we know that in the toilet, we do not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on our tongues. So does one say Bismillah or not? The answer is that it is best, insha'Allah, if you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart, at that moment, that would suffice, insha'Allah. As for verbally taking the name of Allah in that toilet, in that bathroom, where we have the toilet lavatory very close by, then maybe the best option is not to do it audibly, not to do it on the tongue, insha'Allah. So that was A for Allah, and B is Bismillah. B is also for bleeding, subhanallah. When it comes to the chapter of wudu, we find that bleeding is a mas'ala which comes up. What happens, for example, if the individual is in some sort of sport and he falls down or she falls down and they have a bruise, they have a cut. Does this invalidate my wudu or is my wudu still fine? We find that majority of the scholars of the opinion that blood exiting from any wound on the body, this does not break your wudu. Whereas the Hanbali scholars and the Hanafi scholars of the opinion that the wudu is invalidated. What are some of the proofs of majority of the scholars? They said that number one, Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, he was in the masjid and we know that he was attacked in the masjid and he bled. He was later taken to his home and when he came around after his state of being unconscious, they say to him that Ya Amirul Mu'mineen, Salah, you have not yet prayed Salatul Fajr. And what did he say? Yes, there is no shame in Islam for the one who does not pray. And blood was gushing out of his body, but he made sure that he prayed his Salatul Fajr. So this shows us that Umar was of the opinion that blood exiting from the body, it does not invalidate one's wudu. We also find, for example, the basic rule of the Sharia, the asl, that once I have performed wudu, I know that this is 100% yaqeen. I am in a state of wudu. The one who states that blood exiting from a wound breaks wudu, he is the one who has to prove that wudu has now been broken. The onus of proof is upon him. We also find the companion Abbad radiallahu ta'ala an. He was performing salah, and while in salah, subhanallah, the enemy attacked him. They shot him with an arrow and they shot him a second time, but he continued his salah. This teaches us what? This indicates to us that according to him, the blood emanating, exiting from the body, it is not something which nullifies the wudu. We also find narrations from Abdullah ibn Umar that he had a pimple, he burst it and the pus exited and he continued with his salah, walhamdulillah. And that's the opinion, as we said, of majority of the ulama, that blood exiting from the body other than the private organ, then this is something which does not nullify the wudu, walhamdulillah. So that was A for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. B was for Bismillah. We begin our purification, our wudu, tayammum, ghusl. We begin them all after taking the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we also said B is for bleeding and blood exiting from any wound in the body. It does not nullify the wudu, walhamdulillah. The next matter, and B is also for a bandage. Maybe the individual has a cut and so he bandages up that finger, bandages up the foot. He has a bandage on his arm. Does this nullify the wudu? Does this break the wudu? Bi-ithnillahi ta'ala, we will discuss the masail pertaining to wiping over the bandage once we return after a short break. Hayyakumullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We continue bi-ithnillahi ta'ala in our series A to Z of purification. Before the break, we discussed A for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. B was for what? B was for Bismillah, before our wudu, our ghusl, and our tayammum. B was also for bleeding. What happens if I have a cut? Does it nullify my wudu or not? We saw majority of the ulama state that your wudu is intact and it is fine, walhamdulillah. B is for bandages. Sometimes the individual might have a cut on the finger and so he's bandaged this finger and he asks or she asks, what do I do at the time of wudu? Do I remove it? Do I insert water into the wound? Do I decrease my chances of it curing itself, it healing itself faster? No, ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah. We have a principle in the Sharia that when times get tough, the Sharia makes it easy, walhamdulillah. La darar wa la dirar. There is no harm that the Sharia wants you to involve yourself in. And thus, we find that all you need doing is putting a bandage around the finger, bandage around the arm, around the foot, wherever it might be. Then what happens at the time of wudu? Do I wash the bandage? What exactly do I do? The answer is, you wipe over that bandage, inshallah. You wipe over that bandage and that would suffice, walhamdulillah. And the wiping over the bandage is very different to maybe wiping over the sock. What's the difference? Well, one difference is that when it comes to the bandage, you do not require taking a fresh wudu and then tying on the bandage, as opposed to the sock. We find when it comes to wearing the sock, you need to take a fresh wudu, put on your socks, and later on you can wipe over them, inshallah. Whereas the bandage, no precondition of a wudu. You just have a wound, you have a cut, tie on a bandage, walhamdulillah. And with the bandage, it helps you with your wudu and it helps you with your ghusl. As opposed to the sock. The sock only aids you in wiping when it comes to wudu and not with ghusl or anything like that. A third difference with the sock would be that we wipe over the entire bandage. Whereas on the sock, we only wipe over the upper portion of that sock. And the fourth difference is that when it comes to the bandage, you can wear a bandage for 1 year, 2 years, 20 years, for as long as you require, and you wipe over it, walhamdulillah. Whereas with the sock, we know as a resident, you only have the time span of 24 hours, and as a traveler, you have the time span of 72 hours. So those are four differences between wiping over the bandage and wiping over the socks, walhamdulillah. So we said again, B was for bandages. At the time of need, we are allowed to tie on a bandage and we wipe over the entire bandage. But one matter to take note of, sometimes the brother Ahmed maybe, he has a cut on the finger and subhanallah, what does he do? He bandages his entire wrist. Would this be correct? This would not be correct. Why? Because brother, We allow you the concession to tie the bandage. We allow you the concession to wipe over the bandage only for the area that you've had the cut or the area adjacent to the cut. As for the entire wrist, then absolutely, absolutely not. Walhamdulillah. We move on, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, to the letter C. When it comes to purification, the letter C ties in with what? C for what, brothers and sisters? C for circumcision, yes. C for circumcision. We know, subhanallah, that our father Ibrahim alayhi salam, at what age? In his 80s, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders him to have himself circumcised. And we know that even amongst the Jews, circumcision is something which is practiced up till today. And within the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, within Islam, the practice continues unabated, walhamdulillah. Many a scholar of the opinion that circumcision for the young guy, for the male, it is wajib. Many a scholar of the opinion that it is wajib for the male, walhamdulillah. Subhanallah, ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah. If, for example, you had to look into this matter from the angle of medicine, one finds that the rate, the chances of contracting HIV/AIDS, if one is circumcised, it's much less than the one who is uncircumcised. So, subhanallah, besides the benefits of following the Sharia, besides the benefit of following the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Anbiya before him, because circumcision was a practice of even the Anbiya before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we also get the benefit, the health benefit, walhamdulillah. So, ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah, the matter of circumcision. Take note, sometimes we find a brother with a lot of zeal and he has a friend who maybe enters the fold of al-Islam. So he says to the brother, MashaAllah, you are now a Muslim. One of the first things you need to do is what? You need to circumcise yourself. Allahumma musta'an. And maybe the brother is new to Islam and he's a bit reluctant. He's a bit afraid. He's at the age of 29. He might even be 50 years old. And he says, no, circumcision, too painful for me. I don't think so. Then the brother, he says, no, well, you cannot be a Muslim if you do not circumcise yourself. Then what happens? Well, then the guy says, you know what, if that's the case, this is too painful for me, I'm going back to my old ways. I'm going back to Hinduism, or I'm going back to Christianity, or atheism, or whatever ism it might have been. Ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah, we advise our brother that you can be a Muslim even if you did not circumcise yourself. Ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah, what's more important? It's more important that the individual enters the fold of al-Islam, subhanallah. Rather, we say to our brother that if you become Muslim and you are uncomfortable with circumcising yourself, it is more important that you remain Muslim, walhamdulillah. It's not a precondition for your Islam that you are circumcised, walhamdulillah. Ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah, we move on to the next letter, and that is the letter D. When it comes to purification, the letter D comes in where? Ties in where? What benefits do we get here? D is for the dog, ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah. Or in Arabic, the kalb. As one imam, he had said to his congregation, that brothers, you need to make salah with your kalb. But this imam's tajweed pronunciation was not good. So he says, brothers, pray with your kalb. The next day, a brother comes to the masjid with what? He brings his dog. So the imam, he needs to update his tajweed pronunciation. What he meant was, pray with your qalb, brothers. Pray with your qalb. Qalb is the heart. And as for kalb, that is the dog. D is for the dog. Ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah. Muhammad ibn Abdullah, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayh. He has stated that if in any of your guys' utensil, وَلَغَ فِيهِ الْكَلْبِ, the dog comes along and it drinks from this utensil. Then what do you do? Wash it 7 times and 1 time with soil, 1 time with sand. This was now for that shepherd. He's out there in the middle of the desert. He has a few utensils that he drinks from, eats from. Comes along his dog and drinks some of that water, eats from that utensil of his. How does he purify it? How does he clean it? Take it and wash it 7 times, and one of those times, rub some soil in it. This indicates to us that the saliva of the dog is something which is najis. What does najis mean? Najis means impurity. It is impure, it is najis, or as some would say, napak, it is impure. And that's the way to cleanse yourself. So if, for example, the dog's saliva came onto your hand, came onto your garment, etc., then you wash it off. You wash it off, one time would suffice, inshallah. But if you want to eat from the utensil, it's your plate, your bowl, and the dog's eaten from it, then you wash it seven times, and one time with soil, walhamdulillah. Majority of the scholars also pulled from this hadith, extracted from this hadith, that this shows us that the saliva of the dog is najis. So if the dog brushes against your garment, the dog's tail touched your trousers, the dog's paw touched your hand, you do not require washing anything off because there's no remnants. But if the saliva of the dog came onto your garment, then you wash it off, walhamdulillah, and that would suffice bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. The next matter, and that is D for defective bleeding. The female who has defective bleeding, what is this? This is istihada in the Arabic language. Istihada is this female who is suffering from istihada, chronic defective bleeding. This is maybe due to some illness. This bleeding does not affect anything, walhamdulillah. She still prays, intimacy with the husband still allowed, she still fasts, she can make tawaf of the Kaaba, she can recite and touch the noble Quran without any problem whatsoever. This bleeding is just like getting cut on the hand, walhamdulillah. What we would say to the sister, as our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has stated, that because she has this continuous bleeding, and then at the beginning of every salah time, she takes a fresh wudu. So at the time of salatul dhuhr, she would go clean herself off first and then take a fresh wudu and perform salatul dhuhr. At the time of salatul asr, she cleanses herself out, removes that blood, and then takes a fresh wudu. Even though while she's taking wudu, there might be release of blood. Even while she's praying, there might be release of blood. No problem whatsoever, because there's nothing else that she can do. And that's the ruling with regards to the female in istihada, walhamdulillah. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, we come to the end of this episode. And we've dealt with the A to Z of purification. We've covered A for Allah, B for Bismillah, B also for the matter of the bandage, the matter of bleeding. C was for circumcision, and D for the dog and defective bleeding, walhamdulillah. Your brother in Islam, jazakumullahu khairan, Bilal Ismail, been with you. Hayyakumullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Allah, Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you. Allah, Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you. Allah, oh my Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you. Allah, oh my Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you. Allah. To you, Allah, oh my Allah, you are my Lord. I bow to you, Allah.